company business today. And over the last decade, it's become very clear that in order to do the best pulsar timing analysis, the most robust timing analysis, it's essential to have detailed models for what's undergoing, what's in your pulsar timing data. And unlike in a lab like this, where you have a lab where you can go in and drill things, you got pulsar timing distances and thousands of light years. Travel through vast space between vast space between the neutron stars and us, and are affected by the interstellar medium. The processes that are both in the interstellar medium, but the interiors of the neutron stars are not well understood. So that means that the noise that we observe is typically not that well understood, and only have noticeable models for what it is. So, and it's clear that what happens is that if we don't have the right models for the noise, we can end up in situations where we have what's called misspecification. And we can end up in situations where we come to the wrong conclusion. So, what we're going to discuss today was some of the things that are in these data sets. It's a very rich field, and it's also very, depending on how you look at it, think of it as the noise, but you can also think of it as a signal. Because what it's telling us, it could be about the interiors of neutron stars, right? Neutron stars, interiors that could have superfluids, something limited, like the light is open, it's like, unconfined quarks in the center of these things, right? But the rotations of the neutron stars are being affected by the angular momentum transfer between the superfluid and centers and across the crust. So you're learning about that. You're also learning about the interstellar medium. The diffuse matter between pulsars and us, and Matthew showed some of the interest for Jeff has been doing about studying Gao shocks as a pulsar collides with the interstellar medium. So, I'll just take a step back, and I hope at the end of this workshop you find also timing as interesting and wonderful and powerful as I do. We'll discuss the noise processes that we see in pulsar datasets, and then how we find and characterize them. So we'll start with this approach where I'll sort of give you, we'll give the recipe at the beginning, and then after my talk, we'll go in and do some practice. Right, so again, really the power of the pulsar timing technique is the fact that it is phase-dependent. So, we talk about detecting exoplanets, for example, planets around other stars, we're using the radial velocity technique, right? So all you're measuring is the redshift and blueshift of the stellar spectra due to the planet. That's not phase-dependent, this is phase-dependent. So we're able to measure effects that only cause modest redshift changes, and they'll accumulate over time. And when Matthew yesterday showed the effect of gravitational wave emission from the Taylor binary pulsar on the fact that effect was so strong is because of the phase coherent technique. That over the course of years, decades, that tiny bit of loss, that orbital decay accumulates. And it accumulates very strongly. In the case of something like that, it gets scales as time to 5 hours. So, we talked about this, right? We search gravitational waves, we test GR, measure masses of neutron stars, and again, measure masses of neutron stars, tell us about the conditions of state. We can also study the interiors of the interspheres of neutron stars as well. Best timing, of course, is with millisecond pulsars, and this is for two reasons. One is the most stable rotations. So they spin quickly, but they also spin stably. So that's probably related to the fact that we have relatively weak magnetic fields, but there are three other reasons. On top of that, the millisecond pulsars have the narrowest possible profiles. So that means that we can precise time, time tenor. So if we've seen, you've seen the equation in the previous slides about how timing precision scales is possible with by less than the square ratio. If you're spinning quickly, you turn your head in. So when we talk about pulsar timing, the common assumption is that the radio region is aimed at the neutron square. So what we're doing is we're really measuring rotation of the pulsar itself. We also typically assume that the condition is stable. That epoch, every epoch, we expect the pulsar profile to converge in the same shape. There's been exceptions known about this for decades. In the case of double neutron star systems, you can have relative succession where the pulsar beam contested in a lot of sight, famously appeared with the pulsar. You have to estimate where the beam pulsar has disappeared. And it won't appear again for decades. However, for most pulsars, isolated pulsars, especially, at least we expect the consumption to set in the shape. On top of that, one of the key points is that most of the signals of interest that we're looking at don't alter the pulse shapes. Right? So gravitational waves don't change the shapes of pulses. GR doesn't change. Well, aside from recessive, it doesn't change the shape of the shapes of pulses. So that means that we've got a great signature. So again, here's just a nice model for neutron star, of course, right? We think most emission comes from the polar cap, periphery, millisecond fault, and your pulsars, as well as other interesting regions where they emission. But we think all that action happens here in the light cylinder. The light cylinder is the region, the space which can co-rotate the neutron star. So outside the light cylinder, co-rotation is faster than the same way. So, the currency of pulsar timing at the moment is arrival times. So some of us made arrival times yesterday. Some of them had the right observatory code, some of them did, but we'll figure out what reasons why that worked later on. But then really what's in these things is an immense rich field of astrophysics. So going from sort of the pulsar where the emission comes from to the Earth, encoded in the pulsar spin down. So the pulsar is again taking its sort of rotational potential energy and converting it into pulsar waves, gamma rays, and a very tiny amount of radio waves. Right? Most of the energy budget from the pulsar is coming out in a pulsar wave and measurement. That's it, of course, because it doesn't necessarily have to be. On top of that, there could be variations in pulse shape and the phase of emitted pulses that is in the arrival times. The pulsars, a lot of them are binary systems, well, a lot of the cyclic pulsars are binary systems, and we see the reflex of magnets. We see the effect of passage of the Earth through the solar system, around the sun, and passage of the pulsar around across the sky in terms of measuring the pulsar position with proper motion resistance. As I mentioned, there could be stochastic spin-down variations. And we're getting more and more confident that what we see, we're receiving the effects of gravitational wave passing through the pulsar. On top of that, we mentioned in the past, the theories are that there's more electrons than we saw here. And as pulsar line of sight changes, that column changes. And that variation in that hollow is going to cause frequency-dependent effects, and it's more than one effect. Then this is the solar system itself. So where's the center of the solar system? Well, the sun's like, which way is the sun? That way, right? So it's like pretty close to the center of the sun, right? But it's not quite the center of the sun because of all planets, right? You see, you have to know the masses and the positions of the planets as well. And you talk to people at NASA, and they say, oh yeah, we know where it is. But the big issue is that it depends on very complicated models of the dynamics of the solar system. turns out it's actually probably easier to get improvising your spacecraft to fly the way over a couple thousand kilometers of Pluto than it is to go to the solar system. So it's very open to understand that as well. So, we talk a lot about stochastic processes and random processes in our data. And just to give a few examples of what we mean by that. So like in terms of deterministic processes, we think about things that if the initial state is known, the future state can be predicted. So that, you know, if we have a model for pulsar white dwarf, if we know masses of the objects and initial positions, right, we can predict how it's going to do, right? If we have a graph bar file, which has a binary model, we should be able to predict that it was known. The other end of things is stochastic processes, right? So these are seemingly random things, right? The system evolution depends on random variables. So, you think of things like the positive microwave background, which is, you know, related to fluctuations in the universe, or the gravitational background. Pulsar timing is the same way, but we don't really know how they expect the pulsar timing. Rotation regularities are all the time. And there's things in between. So here's an example of a deterministic process in the pulsar timing data set. So this is data taken from the Prof Ryan Shannon of the best pulsar pulsar, measured on it. And the top is showing the best model for the pulsar. And the bottom is showing the model where I have to assume nothing about. We assume that multiplying is basically. And so what you can see here, the residuals, this is over about 1 inch data, that you can see here that there's probably these wobbles that occur every 6 months. And this is the timing paradox. This is the fact that the waves from the radio waves from the pulsar, as they pass through the solar system, are actually curved. And this means that we measure the distance to pulsars. This also means that if you had a gravitational wave with a period of 6 months, you would be able to see it. So in the future, you might see plots where people plot sensitivity curves for pulsar timing to gravitational waves, and they often have big spikes at periods of a year and a half a year. And that's because of the fading of the pulsar position. So then, of course, we've seen this before. So this here looks somewhat like what we call QM. And if we had, if the pulsar had a significant frequency second group, it would produce the QM. And if you think of some young pulsars, actually, as having that due to this process called pulsar breaking. However, this is a key for QM. This is So how do we quantify this? It's nice to sort of fit polynomials to things. It's often more simpler to model these sort of noise processes in the frequency domain rather than the time domain. So the frequency domain is Fourier domain. And what we do is we decompose the signals into a series of sinusoids. So, you know, we think the sine wave is having a frequency and amplitude of a phase. Or we think of it as having a frequency and having an amplitude and a cosine component and an amplitude and a sine. And this allows us to do two things like do Fourier transforms, where we now decompose something that looks like this into a series of sinusoids. And there's this algorithm called fast Fourier transform, which is a really efficient way of calculating the Fourier transform as well. This allows us to do the efficient. On top of that, what we can do now also is take the sort of square Fourier transform, and that means in the complex, and also sense that it's And this allows us to avoid something called power spectrum. And this power spectrum is what's nice because if we don't care about the phase of the signal, like if we don't really care, you know, the universe doesn't really care, pulse stream shouldn't really care if it's 1984 or 2023, so we don't care from the start, so we're crazy. And that just allows us to throw up our eye, ignore that, and characterize the signal in a way that it's like. So, if you, I really encourage everybody in the room, if you haven't already, to really think about study up on various transforms and sort of thing, if you're interested in also having the time series analysis in general. It's sort of a methodology that's very useful and it's very simple to model. Here I'm showing you examples of what things look like when you do Fourier transforms as well. So, in terms of the types of signals that we expect to see pulsar timing, we largely decompose them into two things: white noise and red noise. So, when things are white, we mean that they are uncorrelated between observation and oscillation. So, and they can be thought of as having a flat power spectrum. So the power is equal at all frequencies. Red noise, on the other hand, is correlated. So that means that if I have two observations close together in time, they're likely to be, have more similar arrival times than two observations that are separate. So there's different ways to think about these things. You can One example of, I think, this red noise is primary bar. So, I've done some simulations of it in an amateur class where you look at things like red box. But we call these red noise because they have red power spectrum, meaning if I was looking at frequency here, and now this is not frequency in terms of radio frequency, this is frequency in terms of like fluctuation frequency, so this is like, imagine this is nanohertz for this axis here. They have more power on those than however, while these two things are sort of the typical model for things, they don't have to be that. There could be bad limited things. We think interesting spectrum that only have power and some sort of frequencies. And we have to be wary of that and be cognizant of that future case. And really one of the issues is that if you model that limited process, it's a red noise process, are you going to get more answers? Are you going to mistake when you detect gravitational waves? Are you going to miss the gravitational waves? It's a problem as well. So we have to really care about this. So typically we model these power spectral densities as power law. So what appears here should we say is that power is the frequency is proportional to frequency power alpha. And sometimes it's F minus alpha, which is very annoying. It's very annoying conventions here. But anyways. So basically, it means that the process is here. So the gravitational waves goes F here, and this is power frequency minus 15. So white noise, this is a process that's uncorrelated on arrival time to arrival time timescales. The fundamental source of white noise in our data is the telescopes themselves. Our telescopes have finite system temperatures. The sky has a brightness as well. And then the brightness contributes noise to our data. So, there's really interesting things we can think about the number of photons that the telescope receives from the radio waves, and compare that to the number of photons it receives from thermal processes. It's, it means that everything's Gaussian, but it also means it's a fundamental. However, there's other contributions to the arrival time variations, especially with telescopes like Big Hat, which are very sensitive. So that if we see examples in the future slides, but this is just showing data taken from another very sensitive telescope, the Hercules radio telescope. And you can see here observations taken at three different wavelengths, three different frequencies. And what you see here is that the arrival times again, the error bars at this frequency, the error bars are much smaller than the scatter. distribution of noise due to the radiometric equation. Well, this and what we see here is that there's an excess capacitance in that. And that's due to the Pulsar variation. And now to look at the correlation of the arrival times between these different frequencies, I would say there's a very strong correlation. So that arrival times that are late at low frequency are late high frequency as well. So this is intrinsic to the pulsar. The radiometer noise itself, the telescope itself, the noise should be independent between different frequencies. So this is due to the Pulsar variations. When we do our pulsar timing, what we need to do is account for this, right? If we're to do our pulsar timing, assuming these tiny little error bars here, we could get our answer could be wrong, right? Because you know, you can imagine this situation here where these aren't observations on your over an hour, but you have like just this is an observation close to, so for example, like a Shapiro is like, right? Imagine you just have this one little tiny observation up here. That's all you have. And that was close to Shapiro. You're going to make a mistake of overestimating Shapiro delay and getting a massive tiny bump and then getting a massive white at the turn start of the bomb as well. So, we all, those of us in Pulsar Timing know about the famous joy division plot. But you know, this sort of variation here is not surprising. You can look at individual pulses from young pulsars taken with sensitive telescopes, like here, so you can see that the pulse shape variation is very possible. And we can quantify exactly what we might expect. This is the strength of this effect should be in condition of timing observations as well. We now know that this is at way 3. We are a contribution to the arrival times. So, we can do that in terms of things that keep me up at night. This is not that it keeps me up most of the day, but we do need to make account for this, and if we don't, it's going to affect both. It's going to affect your frequency. So that's sort of, I guess in terms of white noise, the other excess sources of white noise have to do with interference. There could be just basically things that are going to be independent from observation to observation. So interference that from GPS satellites, electric fences, mobile phone communications, aircraft communications, those signals, while they have the same properties between different observations, are not going to be the same. And those distortions are going to be so that also makes a contribution to white noise, but we need to account for that as well. So we've spent a lot of our time best pulsars and most rotationally stable pulsars. But there are also a lot of pulsars that are very highly rotationally unstable. So this is the Vela pulsar. This is the brightest pulsar at a centimeter decimeter wavelengths. Same kind of times. Both the Parkes radio telescope, but also the Hubble radio telescope in South Africa for a long time. And this is just an example of how its rotation can be tracked versus time. So the pulsar itself shows what are called glitches. So every few years, the pulsar suddenly spins up. And then you can see those here as these pulses, right? And if I was to look here at the pulsar and count its arrival time versus time, I would see that that the pulsar relative to zero here is showing the arrival time instabilities in the order of 1,000 rotations. So we think we can kind of keep track of these things, and that's why, despite this being so large, that this is what we call phase connected. Even if we do an after count these glitches, we can see here it's got this very strong time correlated variation, right? So this is like the red noise symmetry, right? Here's another example. This is an analysis recently done by Mark Slower showing timing residuals for another pulsar over 50 years. And this is now data taken from telescopes in California, but also Parkes, the Atlas Telescope in Australia. You can see here now these very smooth ground strength variations. It looks almost like a cubic, but it's not. So this is, again, very noisy. So for young pulsars, this sort of signature is attributed to stimulus from the pulsar. So this could be due to stochastic interactions between, as I said, the core of the neutron star and the crust. It could be due to crust quakes. But it could also be due to stochastic processes happening in the main beam as well. However, another pulsar is there could be contributions caused by orbital motion. I don't know, I'll show an example of your potential model for that, in a couple slides. But it's also due to a very interesting medium and, of course, gravitational motion as well. So, as I said, most young neutron stars show sort of red spin noise. The question is this observed in a generic property in most other pulsars as well? Or is there a case to be made that millisecond pulsars with much lower infrared magnetic fields are this is an important point. One of the more concerning things about red noise is that it can have similar spectral properties to gravitational. Meaning, it could have power spectral density, which is close to the minus 13/3 of expected gravitational noise. So, again, I show you here that this is timing from the first millisecond pulsar, and it definitely has intrinsic red noise. Here's red noise potentially in another millisecond pulsar. You can see here now, red noise could have sort of, the cubic, some figures will go some way, some will go the other way. So that's just probably the noise itself. But of course, one of the best millisecond pulsars in this data set show no evidence for any sort of red noise. So what you really need to do is at least search for this noise in any of things and account for it when you do your pulsar timing inference. Interestingly, when people first looked at this pulsar, they said, oh, it's definitely red noise. But upon further review, people were able to go and look at the Gaia satellite database, and they found a star moving across the sky with the same proper motion as this pulsar. So now this is thought to be due to a wide kind, something that's, could be in hundreds or thousands of this would produce by your order. So, anyways, but that doesn't mean that red noise from pulsar rotations with the pulsar doesn't exist in pulsar times. The other thing, as I mentioned earlier, is that while lots of it is probably intrinsic to the neutron star and related to the neutron star interiors, there's also some pulsars which show evidence for magnetospheric sources of spin noise as well. So, in this analysis, this is again an analysis of the young pulsar. What we saw was that the pulse shape was changing with time in this quasi-periodic way. And along with it, so that this is the pulse, this is a different measure of the pulse shape. And along with it was the pulse spin down. So new dot here is changing the same way. So when new dot is changing quasi-periodically, that means that there's going to be some sort of quasi-periodic time. So there's an interesting question as to which is the tail, which is the tail and which is the dog? Was it the pulse shape was changing causing the torque shape variations, or was it the torque variations causing the pulse shape variations? And astronomy often is not, causality cannot be easily identified. But the fact that these kind of things can exist for pulsars means that we should be really on the lookout. And when we look at those other problems as well, we should be cognizant of the fact that there could be pulse shape changes. And this pulse shape change might be related to noise in the pulsars themselves. the issue, one of the things I did was look at timing noise in pulsars, and this is in days when PTAs were sort of 5 to 10 years old, and there wasn't a lot of the type of timing of millisecond pulsars was just in its it's not as mature as it is today. And what we looked for was the correlations between pulsar spin period, spin frequency derivatives, and the strength of the timing noise. And what's shown here is just the strength of the noise relative to the spin frequency across measurements in the literature. Solid signals are measurement of timing noise, and open symbols are only upper limits. And you can see here, obviously, that this correlation is here, where the timing noise is stronger in pulsars that are spinning slower. If you're now to look at spin frequency derivative, there's also a correlation, but it's less pronounced. So what we concluded was that spin noise will be present in MSPs if they're observed for longer periods of time or higher frequencies. So that really, if you're doing your gravitational wave searches, you need to at least consider the fact that there could be spin noise from the user. So the other thing about this, though, is that you need to account for this when you're doing any sort of analysis as well. So I talked about gravitational waves being the be-all and end-all, but you might care about measuring the most accurate, finding the most massive neutron star frequency, right? Because you find that neutron star that is 2.5 solar masses, here's perhaps a star, be ready to look on their lattice gate experience for quantum chromodynamics, right? However, you want to write your 2.5 solar mass neutron star paper and you realize you haven't accounted for the fact that the pulsar is spinning, right? So that's the form of the specification you need to. So, anyways, I'm certain that most of the most of the noise in the cell pulsars themselves is due to, so most of the noise in young pulsars is due to many interactions within the cluster itself, and that I'm hopeful that renoids in millisecond pulsars, a lot of it could be through gravitational waves, or be interested in pulsars, or the other reasons as well. We think that we can go. So, one thing that we looked at is what happens if you have low mass disks of things around pulsars. And can that cause things that look like renoids in millisecond pulsars? So we know that I think that millisecond pulsars were produced, recycled from the different stratify pattern. That's good. It's positive if you start spinning at millisecond periods, and somehow it's also positive to lose their magnetic fields to be reduced as well. However, there is a fraction of millisecond pulsars that don't have pattern connections. So their connections disappear, right? And we see what we're called black widow pulsars, where the millisecond pulsars that are ablating the packets, so it kind of makes sense that you go from pattern to kind of start being spun up and then some of them destroy the packets. The question is, can they leave around the material? We know of one millisecond, there's a few millisecond pulsars with planet mass dependence. There's tons of it. There's one that thinks the three sort of where the center mass planets called neutrons. However, so you can imagine a situation where you have multiple asteroids around. And it turns out you can kind of get reasonable results for just a handful of objects for a paper pulsar that can cause residuals comparable to what we observe in this pulsar. So anyways, it's an interesting experiment. You can show things like this can be dynamically stable over distances. So that was all about age. red signal in most MC data sets is due to variations in dispersion measure. So this is due to the control plot worldwide site. So what we're showing here is now residuals on the x-axis, time on the x-axis, and residuals on the y-axis over the course of around 10 years of observation. And different colors are showing the different wavelengths. So red is the longest wavelength, and blue is the shortest. You can see here that the long wavelength, you have this big transfer, and these big wiggles. And that's predominantly due to associations with the DM durations. So to get rid of this, what you need to do, to mitigate this, what you need to do is account for this using a wavelength-dependent model. So this is what we do, and but it's important when you do this that you include models for any other signal, any other stochastic signal that you use every day, so plus kind of sold into your model for these sort of things. So what the key is, remember if you were just to observe the pulsar at one wavelength, like this wavelength here, you would be able to tell the difference between this model here and gravitational, right? You just had one signal and say, oh, this would be a gravitational. So we need to do multi-frequency observation. The telescopes like NearCat now, we have systems that have wide bandwidth, so we can get a good wavelength coverage just with one observation, which is very nice. This is from a data set from the International Pulsar Timing Array. it's a bit busy, but basically what this is showing here is how many wireless harms are varying at different frequencies, correcting for the fact that you might start to get a lambda squared DM might be. You can see here, the wireless harms are doing different things. And this is telling us that there's not just DM-like processes in the data. And this is something that we're seeing very prominently in the Meerkat data as well. And really, we're seeing things that happen very strongly with frequency dependent data sets, especially in the more distant pulsar systems. What happens is that if you don't account for this, these processes, what you end up finding when you do the inference is you end up basically the noise has to go somewhere. So when you're doing these inference, really, it's trying to account for all the noise processes in the data. And if your model isn't correct, you end up having this thing called misclassification. What that means is that if your noise budget, for example, only includes dispersion of your noise and decrement frequencies, but you did include dispersion of your noise and scattering noise, that scattering noise gets budgeted as and the incremental noise, again, is the same. This is the channel of noise that we expect the gravitational noise to be in. And you don't want to corrupt that channel, and that's not fine. So we have to be careful with that. So we started this talk by discussing how one of our assumptions is that pulse profiles don't change with time. And then I said, well, the only cases where that's not true is these pulsars which are having a double neutron star system where you're having a concession due to relativity. However, we are seeing the effects of evidence of pulse shape changes in millisecond pulsars. The pulsars that we want to study for gravitational detection as well. So, here's an example of pulse shape variation observed in one millisecond pulsar. We saw this in 2050. And you can see here observations at three different frequencies, 3 wavelengths, required 50% resistance in the systems. You can see here that everything was looking good, and all of a sudden, bam, the residual was dropped by 15 microseconds. The gravitational waves again are 10s of nanoseconds, so this is not great. And when you go and look at the residual wireless lines, the residuals of the profiles, you can see here that the profile grew a little bump at this point. And that's what this plot here is showing you. This is showing you pulse profiles versus time. This is the sort of a difference between these profiles and the template. You can see here that there's an excess. One of the nice things, of course, that I mentioned is that gravitational waves don't distort pulse profiles. So that you can actually imagine developing methods to account for these pulse shape changes. And we did do this here. And you can see here that if you account for the pulse shape changes, you can kind of recover that, account for that, and do a better job of that. Instead of thinking of wireless lines, you basically have to analyze sending a template and analyze the wireless lines. You have any template and making wireless time and analyze those, you have to make a template and send it to your wireless lines. And basically make a kind of fact that it could be also data. So it's a way bigger computation because now you have to model the cost of the same time, right? Like we all did our cost past yesterday, we're adding components right to the fit. And then we can do our time analysis. So now you're doing that every time you do it very well. So it's a big computational effort, and then this happened actually isn't mature yet. So that's one of the big ideas that's going forward, seeing the same problem. So, you might hope it wouldn't be you might call this sort of a one-off thing. This is kind of a rather, in Australian parlance, in Australian English, ordinary means rubbish. Right? So you call this a rather ordinary pulsar. It's not a question of not the best pulsar for doing gravitational researches. However, this pulsar was the best pulsar for doing gravitational researches. And this is taken from your Keck telescope. Observations from pulsars.org.au. There you go. And you can see here that everything is good. This is like one of the best pulsars. This color that I'm showing you, the frequencies of observations, that the GM that's being used here is not perfectly correct. You can see here that the higher frequency observations are a bit below the low-frequency observations. But then things are looking swimmingly, and bam, the same thing happens with this pulsar. Rho times drop by 50 microseconds. This is sort of like the most sensitive pulsar to gravitation. And its pulse profiles only change through the point. So, anyways, so these things exist. These things can be accounted for. Like 10 to the 9, I guess. These are all very familiar things. And it's kind of odd when we see these events, they always kind of look the same way as well. And they always kind of do this exponential calculation. So, we know about this one, right? And, you know, you can do different things. You can try to implement the profile to make a timing method, or you can just say, okay, I'm just going to run this pulsar after a mistake here. But then this question is, what are the effects of a small minimal distortions? So we really need to account for these when we do our graphs. So we talked about the gravitational background previously. Again, it's also, as I mentioned, it's a very power spectrum. Characters are by an amplitude and spectral index, and how we also mentioned how it's manifested in two ways. Basically, it's congruent noise and this spatial equivalency. So we've got so it is this red noise process now that we want to search for in concert while we're analyzing, identifying, and accounting for the astrophysical, so the noise processes that are also. As we mentioned, the spin noise itself is, there's other noise processes that can look like the gravitational background. Also, spin noise can have a similar spectral index. So, of course, we can search these correlations. And, yeah, we're going to see this angular correlation pattern that is. So summarizing this, spin noise is present in some millisecond pulsars, present in some millisecond pulsars. The noise itself has time variability that can be similar to what's in gravitational background. And this is where you have the number of pulses that are needed to detect gravitational background. It might be the case that we need to observe a large number of pulsars and figure out ways to remove the number of pulsars that have in the circles. Yeah, the other issue with intrinsic spin noise is that it really means that trying to analyze, trying to figure out study the gravitational waves using the common red noise, the background noise, or the portion of the gravitational background that is not correlated spatially between pulsars, it's going to be difficult. Because that signal can be corrupted by spinless pulsars as well. So yeah, this plot now is just showing you, again, a plot of power spectrum versus frequency, and it is showing you basically the spectrum for the gravitational background and the spectrum for three different stochastic processes related to random blocks that it sort of pulsars as spin properties. And it turns out that if you had a random block in pulsar spin frequency, it's got a very similar spec, which slopes to gravitational. So, this is one of the exciting things that are in CSS, a lot of astrophysical processes that are there. People don't know, we need more and more sophisticated models for different processes that can be in the Pulsar data sets, and noise budgets have been growing more and more sophisticated with time, so there's a lot of work now that's developing physical models for these timing effects, but then also what I call signal models. So what we mean by a signal model now is maybe I don't care about the astrophysics, I just know that there's many processes that are in the runtime times that are related to the Pulsar's time model itself, white noise and red. So the time model here, I mean, is in for this frequency. So it's a spin frequency between frequency derivative, position on the sky, upper motion, parallax. White noise against real noise, the pulse during instrumental effects. And then red noise is, kind of repetition within it. It can have spin noise and isolation. So it's a very, in some sense, it's sort of trivial to fit and marginalize all of these deterministic time model. But one of it is minimize the stochastic contributions on some gravitational waves. We also need to incorporate the stochastic contributions into the lightning function, and that's what these basic inference codes are that we're using in the next exercise. So here's an example of characterizing red noise. So again, I've shown this Pulsar a lot in various different versions of this plot. And we consider this Pulsar in three different data sets. I'll look at the data from the international Pulsar Timing right first series. Manavrata, the North American Europe, the other data set at the time, and the PDTA. I took the same language as Nandra. And what we want to do is characterize the red noise in Pulsar. We often use the difference packages, and then we use the corner plots for showing the posterior probability distributions. And here's an example of posterior probability distribution from the high decay in black, PDCA in red, and Nandra in blue. And you can see here that they're kind of different. That should be a word. And it's likely because of, again, the process in the specification that there's some other noise process that's corrupting noise measurements. And in the case of this analysis, it's likely to the fact that there's scattering noise that's affecting the nanograph of the other noise. So you can see here how the red noise is louder here, so it's got a higher A. But shallower, so lower circle. Or plots like this are useful for comparing different data sets. So, in terms of interpreting what's going on in data sets and trying to figure out what noise processes could possibly be, really, because what you want to do is given TOAs, you're not given the right noise model. So it's quite a fair amount. The first thing to do is look at the data. You know, so the signals look weird, you have sinus signal trends, or in time, which is a cool phase. We did that yesterday, we saw how this is sine waves and things like the normal phase. So, we'll look at how good the fit is. Is there a high square grid? How good is the blue model? We'll look at the parameters and then also our parameters. They apply it significantly. If you add other terms, like today I have relatively, a much larger than our circuits. So the values make sense. So if you had a pair of measured parallax to a Pulsar and it was minus 100, that's an indication of something funny. There's also often cases where we measure properties of Pulsars in multiple ways. We can measure parallax, for example, due to both the geometric terms, that's the curvature of the variables passing through the toll system, but there's also a way to measure it kinematically as well. Basically, between, see that the little period is changing. We can use that in population concerns. On top of that, I wanted to see if our measurements are consistent with other territories. For example, if we were to take Meerkat data and find that this also has the same noise like right up here, that would be considered this. That would mean that this is something wrong with a Meerkat model, or something wrong with the house model. So in terms of like boring kind of data, Meerkat data sets, for example, to gravitational research is my approach. So the first thing I do is use 10.2, the PLC thing that we used yesterday, to inspect things. One technique I learned from Matthew is basically take data and remove all the most noisy noise and see what's left. Because also since light, the flux intensity changes with time as a function of frequency, it means that some stereoids are really good and some are really bad. So the really bad ones actually don't contribute much to anything, and also you're looking at things just high as well. So removing most of the stereoids and seeing structure is actually quite helpful. It's also very useful to sort by frequency, the back end, look at stereoids serially and see what's going on there. So it tells me a lot about things that are very hard to analyze. Also, averaging together data and time and frequency to see if there's any very time-correlated structures that are hidden, right? When we do our Pulsar Timing these days, we do a lot of observation. We take a single observation, we're typically divided into, say, 16 channels. And the gravitational waves are going to be buried in the average of those system observations together. So being able to average together data and see what's left over. So then I would say, once I'm happy here that things are looking okay, I would go again and check like a maximum update method, like 10.2, to explore the data and figure out what the important parameters are, and also see what noise this is in the data. Then, once I'm happy there, I use Bayesian methods to explore the models. We're going to be using Enterprise today. Enterprise is nice and Python. Python is C++, so that's and not untold at all. Really want to understand how parameters can vary, which parameters and models are supported, and really, why are the parameters and models physical? For example, right now, when we're doing kinetic noise analysis of some Meerkat data, we're finding kinetic processes that scale as radio frequency. Power minus 20. That doesn't make any sense. We're trying to figure out why that is. Then finally, the final thing to do is to really, once you're happy with your Bayesian model, you can now go back and test to see whether or not it's right by really like taking the maximum likelihood noise models and subtracting data. As we sort of discussed implicitly yesterday, we assume that when we do our analysis, all of our analysis, we assume this Gaussian method. And what that means is that when we subtract our best model from the data, what's left over should be Gaussian method. It's not that excellent model. Okay, so in summary, there's a variety of noise processes that you present all the time in data sets. Increment or noise can arise from also from gravitational waves. Chromatic choice is likely from the interstellar medium. Having a good model is essential for making the best use of pulses as tools. These noise processes themselves, they're not seismic noise, some block of them, and there's a lot of astrophysics in it as well, so they're kind of interesting in the same way. All this makes doing the pulsar timing, especially the high speed of the pulsar timing, incredibly fun and interesting problem, and one of the great puzzles of astrophysics. So, very good for some of these models is actually a lot of fun. So, with that, I'll take questions. have some predictions for what types of processes we can do. And that tells us sort of how we do modeling. So in the exercises that follow, you'll be including some of the terms that we think might have to do. The issue is what are other terms that we kind of don't know about, right? So the departments that have physically included, but it's the parts of it that are sort of more phenomenological things, like looking at the data and saying, oh, this value is very beautiful. So the way we model it is we have a sort of a description for modeling it that is modeling it using these power law processes that have different gradients. So that's the first thing. So is that the first approach though? That's the big question. Because we have some sense for what the models can be, we don't have pulses can't tell us exactly what's between us and them, how they're doing, so it's a big challenge. That makes sense. So there is a prescription for how to do things. And if anyone's doing that,
I'm wondering about the number of pulsars that you use that you generate.
Yeah.
In regards to your recipe,
we'll
figure when we get to
yes.
And thousands of pulsars. I mean, is there an easy way to automate it? How do you do it with pulsars?
The question was how do you deal with large numbers of pulsars? And when we do these analyses, it's going to be a challenge. I think this is like having any pulsars has been a big enough challenge. It's right. Do you not agree?
It's good.
it's a big challenge. I think other thing is that when we do the noise analysis, if we've got red noise, it can take a few years for it to become jobless. Then it has to stop the data set. So red noise is a process that only grows in amplitude of time. Like the gravitation of the background will grow in amplitude of time. So it takes like 3 years to see that the pulse is good enough. Then a pulse can come back, but one of the pulses that have been like that today. So yeah, I think it's an interesting thing. But yeah, so there's a practical part that's like, how do you keep track of the noise models for hundreds of pulsars and do that. How do you optimize things? It's another big question as well. So, if you're optimizing for like sort of the gravitational wave background, it turns out that sort of a large number of pulsars that modest kind of precision is the way to go. If you take some other things in your data sets, like maybe a binary supermassive black hole, that's the different way to go. Or the other thing we didn't talk about today was other things you can do with pulsars. Like imagine you had like one of the things you might want to do is find a pulsar orbiting instead of chasing a star, right? Right? That would be awesome, right? And you're not gonna get to you're not gonna get to choose that pulsar, right? That could be a very young pulsar that's got very lots of noise in it, right? And you want to be able to do the best job of doing that as well, right? So you want to account for all that noise when you're doing it. Because if you don't do account for that noise, you're going to, who knows, measure the black holes that you draw, right? Okay. That is non-intuitive. timing star in the orbit, right? So you have four orbits in the timing star. So we have some pulsars that are called black widows. Again, great execution measure there, or an S-Cycle 100 timings. And one of the great tragedies of our galaxy as of today is that the best, most precisely timed, possibly even timed to the highest precision, the one that one day we're going to experience as time to sub nanosecond precision, has a companion that is drawn in here. So we look at pulsars, right? Massive amounts of orbital movements, right? So the orbital period of a neutron star is changing in a random way because of interactions between the spin of the companion and the orbital. Yeah, the question was, can you model it? And it looks random.
It looks random, but it's at a different frequency to the gravitational waves, luckily.
Yeah.
So it's possible that we could model them both at the same time and not lose too much gravitational wave sensitivity.
Yeah.
It's a different
random. Yes, it's a different random, yeah. Thank you. Stuff, beautiful stuff.